Strain Hunters 2011, on the way to the Caribbean. Oy.
In 2011, we decided to do two expeditions in two countries, one Trinidad and one St. Vincent and the Grenadines. The main reason we wanted to do these two expeditions in one movie is to show the whole world the different policies related to drug law in two countries and how it's going to affect those two countries in the future.
I try my best to taste as many different strains as possible. I do consider myself a strain hunter connoisseur. So, and I've traveled, most of my travels are for smoking. So I've been to, you know, St. Vincent, Jamaica, California, Amsterdam, of course, you know. So most of my visits, Switzerland and these places, are specifically for smoking or for finding the strains and seeing what they have out there.
Wicked wings with wicked sauces.
How many sauces you have?
We have 49 flavors.
Which one is this?
This one is mango, I believe. So we have some mango, some honey mustard.
I had strawberry here, incredible.
So how are they, Frank?
They are.
Because they said the world's best chicken flavor.
They are. It's incredible.
Doing so, I've been going to Amsterdam since 2005. And I met Franco first, and we started talking. He asked me where I was from, and you know, we shared a joint and had some good words. And of course, Arian came up with the brilliant idea to do a Strain Hunters episode down here. So, and here we are, you know.
Unfortunately, when we landed in Trinidad just after our scouting trip already a while ago, they enforced the state of emergency. That means there's a curfew from 11 to 5 in the morning. And already the tension that you felt in the island was intense.
It's alleged that a container of firearms came in onto our port and went missing. Now, they announced the state of emergency, stating that they are holding it to find and get rid of the firearms. It's strictly for firearms in the country. So they've arrested a lot of people and they found a lot of cannabis, huge seizures of cannabis, but they've only found something like 50 guns. And Trinidad is a small island with huge, huge amounts of firearms. They don't seem to be going really after these things.
You
you think that these severe laws make it worse, the whole prohibition? You see more problems because of cocaine and arms and no-go areas? Because I remember last time we passed an area, even you could not go in there because it's a no-go area.
Yeah.
This is Trinidad, you know, you have a no-go area, such a small island. How is it possible? You know?
Yeah, no, there are areas that you know, they're very dangerous areas. The arms trade in this country has grown large, very, very large, out of proportion. And the sad thing is the government and the police officers or the police community always seem to associate the firearms trade with the cannabis trade. Whereas it's not true at all.
Trinidad. You're alcohol. Trinidad. Para Trinidad. Cuts and the chicken.
Yeah, man.
Yeah, man.
You need to know the island to be able to judge the situations. And Dr. Green told us exactly where we could be smoking and where it was advisable not to be smoking. We had trips in the car where it was very dangerous to smoke, for example, when we were driving on the highway, because we could be stopped at any point. And when we were driving in the countryside, in the hills, then it was a little bit more relaxed to smoke, but you could notice that it was never completely relaxed. There was always some tension in the air every single time someone would spark up a joint.
They shouldn't rule tobacco joints even in Trinidad, because when the police sees you with those things, you know, they'll stop you and give you a pat down immediately, thinking it's marijuana. In Trinidad, first of all, we do not mix tobacco with our herb.
Yeah.
Right, that's the first thing. And usually, a lot of people, when they smoke a joint, they like to smoke a cigarette afterwards. So some ingenious Trinidadian came up with the idea that maybe before the joint is finished, we should open back the joint and stick a cigarette in it. And that's where Trinidad first came up with the roll-on, because you're rolling the joint onto the cigarette. Right?
How long are they doing this?
Oh, for as long as anyone that I've spoken to can remember. Wow, a lot of us like to break a little tip off the cigarette. It gives it a little more intensity and taste. And then you basically add the cigarette to the end of the joint, just the same way you would add a roach, you know, or a filter. Right? You would put it in, and basically you tuck around the cigarette. Easy to try with a pencil at first. Once it's tight enough on the cigarette without creasing the cigarette, because if you crease the cigarette, you'll get some smoke passing. Just lick and stick. And there you have it. You've got yourself a Trinidad roll-on. This part, the whole thing is called the roll-on. When the pure herb is finished and it gets to the cigarette tastes like the herb. So we call the cigarette part a funk, because it tastes funky.
We had some very, very good sources in Trinidad to scout some marijuana. We knew it was not too great there, and also we knew that the planters were having problems and all moving to really, really small fields.
The biggest field you might come across may be less than a quarter of an acre, you know? And some guys even have three trees in one hole. They plant different places, but they just have one or two here and there. It makes it easier if the helicopter passes over and they see two trees in a spot. They're not going to waste their time to land and take down those two trees. So it's smart, but it's also a lot more hard work.
Well, let's go ahead and walk.
They basically use the unique terrain, the mountainous volcanic terrain, to their advantage. You have to walk really, really, really far. You feel like you're dying. You slip, you squelch, you fall down. The mud itself grabs your feet as you walk. And this all basically helps the growers.
During our scouting mission, we had the chance to see plants growing in the vegetative growth stage mostly. And we imagined that They would have been a little bit bigger, the flowers, during the end of the flowering period.
How many plants you have here in this patch? Like four, 500?
Yeah, more than 500.
And you plant like every time a little bit, so every time you can harvest a little bit. When is the harvest time here?
Harvest time must be more like this month. September month is more harvest
until
time.
Until November.
October, yeah.
We find some decent stuff. And but the main problem of the state of emergency also there you saw is that the planters were really, really hiding their plants between like 1 and 2 square meters, little fields, also half an acre we saw, but pretty low grade quality compared to St. Vincent and Jamaica.
Too much water.
Too much water.
Hey, and the fresh land here that you use, eh?
This is natural soil.
How many years can you use it? Good.
Well, you can use this for about 3-4 seasons straight, but after you have to rest the land.
And then you have to rest it.
Two years? At least 2 to 3 years.
2 to 3 years, and then you can use it again.
And the growers harvest it very, very early. That is because the situation of repression on the island is so bad that they are forced to hide and to cut as quickly as possible. So they don't even actually allow their plants to mature properly, to finish their cycle properly. Because they live in this panic situation, they just want to make sure they get their crop in, they get some money in, and they stay out of jail.
Man, this is crazy. The spicy sativa fresh, it's really... bud is dense here, it's genius.
We need seeds from this later. We need the seeds from this plant, man.
Absolutely.
Yes. And
normally now the people now doesn't want to buy the weed with the seeds.
No, of course not.
They want it easy.
High grade.
We don't want to smoke seeds, man.
Amazing coconut water.
Wow.
Really refreshing after walking here.
Is this how most of you guys live? With the vegetable here?
We plant not only herb, but we plant food also.
It was just astonishing to see how people that just a year or two before were managing major operations indoor and outdoor, now were forced to small guerrilla style grows in their backyard, hidden, in panic, again, fearing the helicopters coming every day. And this is just incredibly bad.
And compared to cocaine, is there more people in prison for cocaine or for marijuana here in Trinidad?
Marijuana by far.
Yeah? What, 3 to 5 or 4 to 5? How does it work?
It can be 7 to 3, you know?
7 to 3?
Yeah.
7 for marijuana, 3 for cocaine.
Yeah.
Incredible, eh?
If one gets caught with anywhere from some leaves to straight up to a kilogram, they can be charged for possession, and they have the option of keeping you in jail for up to a year, maybe. Trafficking is usually short jail time also with a larger fine. If you get caught with a seed, 1 seed, 2 seeds, anything like that, they will charge you for cultivating cannabis, and it's a higher charge than both possession and trafficking.
Experience of 20 years of Africa, Caribbean, Asia, whatever. One small detail, we forgot to check the key of the gasoline. It's 6 o'clock in the morning, and the key is not working.
It ain't going in.
So we're gonna have to break the thing open. What can we do?
It's not working. But don't worry, we'll get there. Right? Train hunters always get there.
Really good, man. Really fucking good.
Now we'll be next. Yeah.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
Good breakfast. It's also a good lunch and a good dinner.
Good power.
actuality, there is cannabis over the mountaintop. As soon as you cross over the mountaintop, you will find little fields, of course, because we're in Trinidad, right? Small plots. But there is herb. You might find even better things than we saw so far on this trip, but we wouldn't venture on this trip into that area, of course, because then, you know, there may be no more greenhouse seeds on the pool. So, you know, we'd stay away from trouble.
We also had a chance to visit a very special location on the island of Trinidad, and that was a really underground small operation right on the outskirts of the city, of the main capital, so in a very, very dangerous situation considering the curfew and the state of emergency.
So guys, we're here in a country state of emergency, Trinidad. A lot of indoor grow rooms are closed down now, a lot of big plants are moved away. So the guys moved completely back into the bush. So
hiding.
Helicopters cannot see it. Hiding, eh?
Yeah.
Real hiding.
How big of a problem is it?
Major problem.
Major problem?
Yeah, major problem.
How long has this been going on?
Even the papers, the newspapers,
yeah.
The price of marijuana, it doubled since the state of emergency, no?
Double the price of marijuana, yeah. On the island.
Double.
These friends, they had a small grow around a veggie field where they used to grow tomatoes and other crops. And they hide their plants, literally camouflaging them in the bush. And they do it by small patches, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 plants together, not more. And they absolutely camouflage those plants so that you, if you stand in at 3, 4, 5 meters from them, you won't see them. It's art what they're doing.
Fantastic, but you're doing a really great job,
respect,
especially in this circumstance. It's so difficult to
man,
grow, you know?
It's so dangerous. Yeah.
The last day we were in Trinidad, on the island, we had a chance to join a special ceremony, the Sabbath of the Bobo Shanti Rastafari community on the island.
Tomorrow we do the ceremony, no?
Yes, tomorrow.
Very, very special people. This is a community within the church that believes in God and our Rastafaris.
Thanks to our Most High for divine guidance and protection. Give thanks to the blessed uprising of our Most High. Give thanks to all brethren that come visit I and I from near and far. You know? The wonderful God who live in us in I and I, King Emmanuel VII.
Adonai
God. Rastafari.
The Bobo Shantis are the second largest Rastafarian sect on earth. And they are very colorful. They pray a lot. They read the Bible, the Ancient Testament mostly. And it was very special to be allowed to film and to document such an incredible cultural feature of the island.
Say that the herb come from King Solomon, and that is the lineage of Christ, you know? So we know, say, even Jesus the Christ, who so smoke herb. When I tell people that, they must feel like if it's some joke, but Christ was the greatest physician, and Christ tell about the herb and teach people about the herbs. So we know that. So within I and I culture, we know, say, that The herb originate from Ethiopia, Africa, because there everything come from. We don't smoke herb for head. We don't smoke herb to get high, to hallucinate, or to enjoy a party. We don't smoke herb for that. We smoke herb for meditation because life is a meditation.
It increases the natural energy vibe in the body.
Yeah, life on itself is a meditation. From you wake up on your bed in the morning, your meditation running. Till you go to bed at night, you know them way they? Even when you're sleeping, your meditation is still running because the mind don't sleep.
The government is openly against cannabis and against even the Rastafari people who use cannabis. But these guys, they live in a way that respects the local community and they show that they can do it. They can use the herb without being harassed or hassled more than a little bit. And this is because they are so strong and so religious and so deep in their thoughts. They don't really deal with the herb, they don't really make a business out of it, but they just grow it for their own use and smoke it for their own prayers and ceremonies. So it's probably the single most accepted way on Trinidad for herb to be approached, even though it's still illegal in that way.
Yeah, Franco.
Wow, man, nice little patch.
What do you have here, Erwin?
They call this Arizona.
Arizona.
You call this Arizona skunk?
Arizona skunk. Really, it's a skunk.
It really smells like one.
See, like you smell this one?
These plants here maybe have about
smell it.
3 more weeks lifespan.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow, it's maybe pungent.
Puke,
huh?
Puke punch.
Baby puke, man. Beautiful.
Three more weeks chemical lifespan for the fatter ones.
Really strong.
You call it the fatter one?
The fatter ones like these, yes, sir? About three more weeks like that. Them days will go more, you know?
So half October?
Yeah.
So you cut most of it half October to half November?
Natural.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Fantastic.
And how many times a year you plant?
Right, wrong, yeah, non-stop.
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 What's this we have here?
This is the next grade of skunk here.
Okay.
Yeah, this is mostly skunk we plant here, you know. This is the next grade of skunk, but this one here is the... We call it Jam Jam.
Jam Jam.
Yeah.
Jamaica.
Come from Jamaica?
Jam Jam.
Okay, that's Jamaica, why it's called Jam Jam.
Yeah, this comes from Jamaica too. The smell?
For me, the
piney. Piney smell.
It looks like a haze, man. Spicy watermelon sort of thing for me.
Beautiful. Chemical watermelon.
Chemical watermelon.
You from know, the like candies. The chewing gum yeah, from the new pack.
Chem melon. Yeah.
That's, by the way, a good name for a new plant. Chem melon.
Yeah.
And 7 helicopters are flying around, I heard, eh? Only for ganja.
Only for ganja.
What about the cocaine? Nobody goes after the cocaine?
Nobody goes after the cocaine because the cocaine, you hear them talking about the big fish them?
Yes.
And them control that, the big fish them control
the big fish
business.
Yeah. With the politicians together?
You understand, well, the big fish them link with the politicians because the politicians is big fish too.
What really worries me, you know, if the lack of herb is going to go on like this, on an island like this, in the future the young people are going to take cocaine because there's nothing else.
Not yet.
And this is where the danger starts. In the Seychelles, a country where I came many, many times, like in the late 90s, they start cracking down on all the planters. There's no planter anymore. Everybody was smoking ganja. Now everybody's taking cocaine and freaking out on crack. Huh. Yeah? And the same will going to happen in the Caribbean in countries if they completely get rid of the marijuana. And then all the cocaine comes through and everybody starts taking cocaine and no more smoking more ganja. This is really, really, really stupid, eh?
What really touched me about the ceremony was the way we were welcomed and the warm vibe and the energy that people gave us. We were really not treated like outsiders and it was just a very special connection that we made with the brothers. I was quite emotional about the whole thing, which was special.
Thank you.
When we arrived in St. Vincent, we immediately realized that the vibe of the island was completely different than Trinidad. The entire island relies on cannabis as their one of their main exports, one of the main cash crops. And as a consequence, even though cannabis is still illegal, the entire attitude is completely different.
Well, how's the weather today? Dry?
Dry.
Okay, and how many guys we have to walk up? Like 6 or 7 now we have now. 10 yeah, bags. It's good, no? Huh? Look here, classic, classic.
St. Vincent has amazing nature. The volcano is a high mountain. The top part has not much vegetation, but the rest of the island is covered in thick jungle, really thick jungle, lush and green. A lot. There's a main rain season, a secondary rain season, and there's pretty much wet showers all year round. There's hurricane seasons as well, and the landscapes are amazing. They're breathtaking. The light is so intense. It shines so bright. If you're not used to it, you really need sunglasses, otherwise you can't see.
Day one, we walked up to the volcano, and remarkable, remarkable what we saw there. Hundreds of fields on the way onto the top, beautiful genetics, a lot of local bush weed in all kinds of stages because people plant the whole year around.
What kind of weed is this?
Jamaican skunks.
Jamaican skunks?
Yeah, mix up.
And this whole volcano is full of little patches everywhere.
Yeah.
How's the soil here? It's really vital, huh? Strong soil.
Yeah, I would say.
Man, yeah? Lava soil, amazing.
What is this here, eh?
This is the polish.
You guys feed anything to the plants?
Chicken shit.
Yeah, and the albatas.
Well, you guys have enough chickens in the Caribbean, so that will work. Yeah. And also here again, when we talk to the farmers, you see that the local high grade they have vanishes after 2, 3, 4 generations because the local weed is always stronger and takes over because it's so dominant with so much pollen and such a big area that the high grade that is being imported mostly through Jamaica has no chance.
Wow, what we have here.
Beautiful, beautiful.
This patch, what a beautiful patch, guys, look. It's incredible, man, this valley, look how nice the sun comes in. And all the way until the other valley, you see only ganja. It's like ganja country here.
Full carrot.
Full.
This is so carroty.
Look different than the other patch you were, eh?
No, all the seeds are the same.
The same, just yeah, mixed up genetics.
Yeah.
But it was very interesting to speak to all the farmers about their land races. We saw different phenotypes of the local bush weed. We saw different ways of how they plant. They have these beautiful, nice little hills because they have this huge amount of rain. Some planters plant like really, really steep. Some planters have a better field. Well, it was also nice to hear that they only plant 1 year on one field or 2 years maximum some, because they give some fertilizer that they can get at the local grocery shop. And then they would leave the field for 2, 3 years and swap to the field next door and start growing there again.
We are 13 hours on the road, guys. 13 hours we've been
beautiful field, yeah.
Hunting for this stuff. Very, very good planters, very good farmers, guys. Taking care of the job. Taking care, yeah. But it's a good country. It's well controlled by the politicians. It's well controlled by the police. They have got good drugs law. And they have good planters, and all of all comes together that they have a good tourism and a good economy. Yeah. The only thing they should do, the Minister of Tourism, they should do like in Thailand, on the coast where the beaches are in the little villages, build like these little shacks and restaurants like they have in Thailand and India and Goa and Samui, you know, where the local people, where like the young tourists that come when they have not so much money, yeah. Later they come back when they have money, you attract the young tourists, they can smoke a little bit, they can enjoy the beach. Because now it's a lot of tourism that goes to Backway and Mystique. But this main island, look how beautiful.
Mm. And it really is the Ganja Island. This is.
We had to walk a good walk to reach the top. It took us a good 4 hours, 5 hours, and it was really, really intense. Mostly because of the climate. We had very hot temperature, very sticky, humid air, and it was really not as easy as some people would have thought. We reached the top, and it was really nice because it was one of the few times that the clouds were not completely surrounding the top of the mountain. So we had really good views of the crater, and we had the chance to rest a little bit, eat something all the way on top, get back some energies for the descent.
I think it's one of the best destinations in the world to come and smoke. Yeah. Government is not too difficult. When they catch you, you're pretty easy. You bail yourself way out, you know, you have more. You're much more relaxed, and look what a nature here, man. Where can you sit like this in a crater? Look.
Yeah, it's amazing. And this Ganja Island.
Ganja, and just
Ganja
around...
Ganja Mountain.
And just around all those hills, we're going to go down, we're going to have a look at two, three more fields. It's everywhere, it's Ganja. And you know, volcanic ash.
Man, it's the best soil.
It's probably the best soil in the world. Also in Hawaii, they have one of those things now, where great marijuana grows.
All the volcanic islands grow great pot.
So if you want to have a really, really good holiday, you rent a big fat ass villa in Dekwe or Mystique with your best friend. You organize a big, big powerboat.
Yeah.
You blast to the other islands. You walk up to the volcano, so you do good training for you and your friends. You have a nice lunch somewhere in the bush. You smoke a big fat joint. You have the best day of your life. You come back in the night in your villa. You chill. You smoke another one, you go to sleep, and you do the next day the same. We call it pura vida.
Pura vida. No discussion.
Let's not forget that these islands are included in the list of the top luxury destinations on the planet today. And there must be a reason for that. The reason is not only the beautiful, pristine waters and the friendly music and beautiful people of the islands, but is also the approach to cannabis. Here you are allowed to smoke and to enjoy cannabis reasonably. Of course, you have to watch out what you do because technically it's still illegal, but you are almost encouraged to enjoy cannabis as part of your holiday, as part of the local culture of the island.
We stayed in a really nice villa, which was quite unusual. And for Australian hunters, we were like staying in the absolute lap of luxury. But that didn't change the fact about the work that we had to do every day.
We decided after renting our villa and scouting around to hide out on Bekwe Mystique. And in that case, we also needed the powerboats, the original powerboats of the smugglers, because there's no other way to go quickly, unseen, into St. Vincent.
Using the boat was a lot of fun, but at the same time required a lot of logistics around it.
Of course, you attract a lot of viewers when you come with cameras and a lot of white people on a black beach.
So we decided to do this really, really rapidly. We've asked the locals to see where can we land quickly, all on a powerboat. We are there in 30, 40 minutes from the from our island to the main island. We jump off or on the boat. We go straight into the jungle to the fields. Nobody sees us, so we are very, very safe and we are very fast. It saves a lot of time. It's cheaper in the end, and it's much more fun. We were looking for is, of course, in each country the best land races and the best fields.
Wow. Look at this, guys. Ganja. Dry room.
Mobile dry room.
That's a little bit different than we do it, eh?
Yeah.
Look here, there's nice shunt with all the wood and the cloth. And the heater here close to it, so it dries a little extra.
Yeah. Gets a bit smoky flavor.
Yeah. Smoke weed, eh?
How do you dry anything?
Which smells really nice, eh?
Yeah, it smells really sativa high, yeah, crystal clear. Crystal clear high. Yeah. Smells a little bit away in snow direction, eh?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Eh?
Yeah.
Sure. It's in that direction, I tell you.
Yeah. Remember, they have a lot of work to clip this. You see the guys are all clipping with scissors here, right?
I know.
They're doing it the American way. Great smell, guys. Really, really great smell. This I want to smoke. I'm going to keep this one for myself. Scouting mission here on St. Vincent, we met Blaka, who had a beautiful field. He had the local bushweed, he had the high grades from Europe and America, and he had some hybrids crossed from Jamaica with other stuff, with local stuff, with American stuff. Unfortunately, when we arrived here on the first day, we find him completely devastated.
Oh, man, it's really, really bad, eh?
The family has no food anymore. The police from St. Vincent located his field by coincidence. They have chopped down everything, like a week before harvesting, 2 weeks before harvesting.
Hey, Blaka.
Yeah, man. Different. What happened, man?
Well, the evil one.
The evil one came.
The evil one came and destroyed everything.
Some of his workers got arrested during the bust and later on released. We had a chance to meet Blaka and talk to him in the field that was cut down by the cops just 2 weeks earlier.
Straight back to zero.
It's crazy, man.
Yeah, they destroy everything. Yeah. Until it's in your hands, it's not in your hands. Yeah, totally.
The best felt, the best field, Simon. This was the best field when we were scouting 2 months ago, you remember, 3 months ago?
Yeah, man.
This was such
this
a beautiful.
Was big plants. This thing reminds us that prohibition still goes on, even in these nice, friendly, tolerant islands, and that the war is never over until it's legal.
All those families and so on is suffering right now.
They're suffering right now because the police cut it down.
Yeah, totally. Yes. And they seem to enjoy doing that. And they're not going to do that, but they take all your facilities, gas bottles and everything, and food and anything that is suitable for them, they work with it. They got to survive. Right now, all bananas and planting, agriculture in the whole, is total devastation as well. There are disease on all the bananas and planting.
There's a disease?
Totally.
On the bananas?
I'm talking about devastation.
In this island?
Right now. And all the traffickers, now refusing these plants.
Yeah, and yeah, it's not allowed because if you import bananas with a disease, other countries are going to make problems. So this is big economic crisis also then.
Yeah, definitely.
The people, people are hungry. Yeah?
So people are hungry on the island, and like the little money that is coming in mostly is from the herb.
Yeah. So basically what you're saying is that because the police cut down the plants, there's going to become more violence and crime in the street.
Yeah, not saying I am going to do that.
No, but some of them are going to do this.
Because the majority is going to do that because they have family.
Okay, if I look at the geography of the island, man, I mean, they can't stop it.
No, there is no way to stop it because well, like,
they can stop this.
You have so many soldiers on this island, you cannot stop it.
Yeah, but to tell you that and so on, they know that the plant is for the seed, or bearing seeds for the service of man. Yeah. And it's God talking there, when you're talking about that, not man. So their law cannot compare with the law of the Creator. So there's no way they can stop this from since creation.
Sure. This is one of the messages we want to show to the people, you know, that everywhere we come and where they clam down on growers, you see more poverty coming.
Yeah. Right, totally.
You know? And the children don't go to school anymore, the mothers have no food, it's terrible.
Massive and you'll stay Espanol, Mr. Rico. Don't ever stand, don't estás, you know? Yeah.
Well, of course, in any expedition of this type, you know, we are dealing with something that's not yet legal, and it is not the safest thing to be doing at all times. We have to be careful. So there is, of course, the element of stress within the situation, but we have a lot of fun. You know, we have a lot of fun out there. Everyone seems reasonable. Everyone gets to what they need to do in the end, and we get it done.
No, 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 bye, bye. I'm about to die, die. Big man say, come through. Suelta, suelta.
Sometimes when we go around, we have to take a break, so one of the nice, interesting breaks we took was in a little village where a party was going on, a little street party. There was a cafe blasting music, and people were smoking, drinking, playing domino, doing all kinds of things.
£50,000
For £100, £50,000, not much change price.
What kind of grade? Jamaican stuff or local? What do you grow? Mix.
Yeah.
What do you think?
More for local or more for export?
Both.
Both.
Yeah.
Yeah, in Vinci, it's the best thing to do, no? Grow some ganja.
Yeah.
Yeah, man. Respect. Full respect.
I'm happy right now. The best. In the West. Vinci. Marijuana. Trust me.
Liar doctor, Indian and chief. Everybody else them who smoke not the weed.
We, of course, created a lot of attention in the street, so we didn't stay too long. But it was very nice to see this rough part of the island, to have the chance to experience the ghetto style living and to see how the rough boys here do their thing, how they talk and how they survive. When you buy a joint on the beach of Barbados or St. Lucia or Antigua or British Virgin Islands, even Trinidad, there's a very high chance that that joint came from St. Vincent. The network of people that is needed to make sure that all this happens is astonishing, is incredible.
We'll have a planter with a few guards taking care of the field. The crop is nearly the whole year around. Then you have the guys with the boats, you have the middlemen, you have the transporter, and with the boats from Zin Vinci, who is the main supplier for the whole Caribbean, it will go anywhere where there will be a demand for cannabis, fortunately.
I'm a transporter.
You're a transporter.
Yes, transporter.
A night walker.
Night worker, only night shift. I work. Only the night shift.
So how does the run work?
Not a lot of people want to work in
the night. It all happens in the night?
No, not all the time in the night. Some people leave in the day and get into the night when they reach the final destination.
Depends how far it is.
Depends on how far it is.
Yes.
Some of these characters we spoke to told us stories that we could not believe. It was really amazing to feel the tension in their voice.
What's the most amazing story that happened to you? You were telling that you were drifting off for 19 days.
19 days.
19 days.
19 days.
And how did you survive on food and on drinks? What did you do?
Well, we catch water in the bow. For 5 days, no water, no food.
Then it rained.
Then it rained, so we blocked the hole.
Yeah.
We catch a lot of water. We put it in a bottle.
Mm.
Well, I'm the captain.
Mm.
Two other guys. So in the day, one guy will bail the water out, and in the night, one guy bail. But me, I don't bail, I'm the captain.
Yeah, but why are they in the water?
Because half of the boat is in the water.
Okay.
Half of the boat is full of water.
Hardcore.
You understand? So sometimes I lie on the bow, and the boat pass, and I, because the boat, they land, I catch the bird, and I take sponge, light it. And I roast the bird. But when you're eating, you're tasting the sponge.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
What the fuck?
Okay, no. Okay.
You're hungry.
And realize that they really are the last pirates. They really are a link in a chain that makes sure that cannabis is produced, delivered, and consumed, no matter if it's legal or illegal.
So in which areas is it the most dangerous to land? Which of the islands were like...
Very close. The closest one, Barbados.
That's the most dangerous one?
Most dangerous.
Why is it most dangerous? Best coast?
Because they don't want to catch you. They kill you.
They kill you. They don't catch you.
They shoot. They don't give a fuck about catching you. They kill you.
Strain Hunters is an authentic documentary. Everybody plays who he is. We don't like to have actors or substitutes for people. And during our short days together, you talk and you talk. And at one point, we explain them their situation that we are in. In the end, our movies could make a difference for everybody. And they realize this. And you build up a slowly relation, and you ask them to tell also their story, to have a bright picture of what's really, really happening in the cannabis world, in which people like me and other people are forced with their back against the wall to make something happen.
Respect, man.
Yeah, man. It's a life you have to live, man.
No shit.
5 kids.
The night worker.
Night worker. Say, honey, say, honey, say, honey, say. Wee-wee bonbons and all the wee-wee stars.
I, of course, being a person that likes cannabis, I love, you know, I deal with a lot of positive energy. I try to keep as positive as possible, believe in a higher power and try to live righteously and truly, you know, in every day to day. And in saying so, you find that in every country, in every place, you feel a different vibe, a different atmosphere. St. Vincent, you land in St. Vincent and you feel light, you feel refreshed. I've had the opportunity to see how people in St. Vincent live, and it's a very, very poor island. Some people work for no more than $200 a month, and they have families to take care of. Yet still, when they are out and people come and they see them, they would take their last dollar to buy something for a friend, right? For even a stranger, right? They are a nicer set of people. They are well-rounded, good, positive-minded people, you know, and the energy reflects it.
Chance to swim in an incredible pool at the bottom of a waterfall in the jungle. The water was so fresh, so refreshing after the heat of the day.
I invite anyone to come to St. Vincent and experience the island.
after chasing the best land race or marijuana available on an island, and sometimes because we lost the field of blackout that was our main priority in the beginning of the mission, we walked all the way up to this volcano to find more and more fields. We saw maybe 100 fields. And sometimes you work 13, 14 hours a day and you see a lot of the same stuff, but you just don't find the Holy Grail.
So we sent Dr. Green for one more scouting on his own with some contact we had on the island, and he came up with an amazing location. All around the side of the mountain, very steep terraces, plants properly spaced, good size and good buds.
Where the first day?
Yeah, up there. All the way,
all the way up there? And then you find a field 50 minutes from the beach.
Amazing.
Incredible, eh?
Amazing.
It was not very uniform, but this was very good to us because we were looking for variety. We were looking to see a good representation of pretty much what the island has to offer, and we had the chance to get that. This field was definitely the most organized we saw. Even the shanty there had proper shelves, and all the material and equipment was neat and tight and clean. The plants were very, very interesting. We came across a few Jamaican crosses with this incredible celery scent mixed to a little bit of lemon, a little bit of mint in some of them, fresh sativas. There were also a few fruity plants. One of them, Dr. Green named Tutti Frutti, and I think he really hit the spot with that name because it was incredibly complex. Most of the plants we saw were clearly sativas because the dominant landrace, the Santa Marta dominant landrace on the island, overpowers any variety that comes in from abroad. It takes about 3 to 4 years, but it eventually gets completely melts into the local landrace. So the planters look for high-grade seeds, demand new high-grade seeds to be able to have some crosses going on, to increase their production, to increase the amount of money they get per pound.
Yeah, mm-hmm. The candy shop. The Strain Hunters Candy Shop, yeah. Ganja Island. Ganja Mountain.
What a nice place.
Ganja Mountain. Ganja Volcano.
Ganja Volcano.
Ganja Volcano.
Ganja Volcano.
And there you see again, you have to do a lot of hours of strain hunting to find the absolute best. You have to be in the parties with the locals. You have to go to the bars, drink a beer with the locals. You have to go to that party. You maybe have to organize a little party for yourself, and then you slowly, slowly find out who is the guy who's got the best high grade, who is the guy who is known to take care really good of his field and his plants, because in the end, that makes a good documentary.